Hey everybody, Lance Platy here, coming at you with a brand new series and a brand new video. I was thinking the other day, like, I kind of want to do some more videos, not sure what on, and then it hit me. I was watching Corridor Crew's VFX Artist Reacts videos, very entertaining, and it got me thinking. I'm not a VFX artist, but I enjoy watching these videos, and I have a lot of people that watch these videos that aren't exactly reptile keepers, so what if I did something similar and just talk about reptile portrayals in movies and TV? So that's exactly what we're going to do today. We're going to look at adaptation, we're going to look at Skyfall, and then we're going to look at a series of unfortunate events, but not the Netflix series, the movie from decade plus ago. All right, so starting with adaptation. Adaptation is a wonderful, wonderful movie. For context here, Meryl Streep plays an author named Susan Orlean who is writing about John LaRoche and Orchid Hunter. So let's get started.
Orchid hunting is a mortal occupation.
Osmers, hey, it's Apollo.
Vanished without a trace in Asia.
So here's the problem with this scene. What a lot of people are gonna consider this is nitpicking, but whatever, you clicked on this video. So this snake that slithers by is a corn snake. It actually looks just like Apollo. It could be an amelanistic morph corn snake, or it could be a reverse Okidi. It doesn't really matter, honestly. So the director definitely made a choice to have this snake slither past. The problem is that corn snakes are from North America. They're not exactly Asian snakes. What they could have done, you can have a Burmese python slither past. Burmese pythons are incredibly easy to train, and they make appearances in plenty of other movies and TV. Adaptation's still a good movie, but unfortunately, with on the snake aspect, they get a fail. Let's look at another clip. Oh, this is John LaRoche. This is actually a pretty good scene. This scene takes place in Florida. The thing that attacks them, obviously, is an American alligator, which are native to the Florida Everglades and are pretty much their apex predator. Generally, alligators do not prey on humans. Obviously, like, people get attacked by alligators in Florida. Alligators understand that humans are not prey items to them. Though there are occurrences where they do sort of confuse humans for prey items in cloudy or murky waters. And it appears that the bog or swamp they are going in is relatively murky. So the alligator made a conscious choice to attack him, not by defending itself.
Nice.
But because it wanted food. They showed
the death roll.
Because crocodilians cannot chew their food. Whatever they're eating, they have to swallow whole. They'll spin to tear off smaller chunks that are easier for them to swallow. Now, what this alligator does to John LaRoche in this scene is exactly that. It grabs onto his torso and just spins to get a smaller chunk. Good on you, adaptation, for employing that, because it's horrifying to watch, and that's the point of the scene, but it's also accurate. So props to you, Spike Jones, for putting that in. Adaptation, where it failed with the snake scene, it gets a pass, more or less, for the alligator scene. Okay, so the next clip is from Skyfall. It's a James Bond movie starring Daniel Craig. I unlocked a repressed memory of my old job when I was talking to my boss about the fact that I own monitor lizards. He mentioned that there were monitor lizards in a James Bond movie. Did not even know this scene existed, so let's take a look. Yeah, it goes from Mission Impossible. Hey, is a buddy. Okay, so right off the bat, that looks like a Komodo dragon. Probably wrote in that they were Komodo dragons. I love that reaction to it.
Good luck with that.
Good luck. I like this scene. This is good. This is good. Komodo dragons are the apex predator on their island, and they actually have been known to attack, kill, and eat humans. They attack and kill much larger prey than humans. Like they primarily feed on like deer and cows, and they have no problem doing that. The thing I like about this scene too is just the way that they've animated this monitor. They nail the movement and they nail the behavior really well. Like you can see this guy when he's crawling out of the little den. He's like just kind of curious what's going on. It kind of reminds me of Bossk when I give him food. Another thing I like too is how the Komodo dragon actually attacks this henchman guy. What they'll do is they'll latch onto the cow's legs and they'll just sort of rip and tear. And they'll use their venom. Some people are going to call me out and say it's saliva, but it's actually venom. They'll come back later on when it's dead and just sort of fight the carcass. So actually my dumb man brain was wrong. Komodo dragons don't actually bite prey and wait for them to die. In fact, they actually heavily, heavily prefer to kill their prey on sight. There's documentation of Komodo dragons killing wild pigs like in a matter of seconds. The Komodo dragon just sort of comes up to this guy, bites his leg, and then drags him back into the den. Slinky, specifically, I'll give him dubia roaches and I'll give him mealworms, grab them, and then he'll sort of run away with them and he'll eat them somewhere else. So that's sort of what this monitor is doing. He's dragging this henchman guy back into his lair where he'll probably more easily feast on him. Sam Mendes, you get a pat. Before we get into this live video, please, I would encourage you to like this video and subscribe if you want to see more content. Okay, so the next clip is from Lemony Snicket's A Series of Unfortunate Events, the movie from 2004.
Time for chit-chat. Hello! Oh my goodness!
It's a Burmese python.
You must be
albino.
How do you do? What a firm grip, like a Burmese python.
Burmese pythons do have very tight grips.
You can pick out the gut worms from the bowel of the viscid boa.
A Viscan boa is not a real boa.
Did you say pack?
Oh yes, we have to pack all the equipment.
That's a sulcata tortoise, but damn, this is a nice shot. Who shot this movie? Emmanuel Lubezki. Oh my god, Emmanuel Lubezki. This dude shot Children of Men, Tree of Life, Gravity, Birdman, and The Revenant. That's insane. Anyway, that's not about reptiles. Let's just move on.
Let's wait to the reptile room.
Oh, that's a lot of stuff. Okay, so bearded dragon looks like some two little smaller sulcata tortoises and then a water monitor. And then that giant skeleton up there looks like it's a I mean, that's not a real snake, right? But closest thing that it resembles is a titan boa, or titanoboa.
Able to grow as large as 40 feet, the titanoboa was a prehistoric breed of snake.
No, not very much.
Over here we have what looks like a BCI boa constrictor and possibly a Dumeril's boa. Both of these snakes are pretty prolific in the pet trade, especially the BCIs, or more commonly known as just common boa constrictors. Although they are portrayed here as just climbing around. Like, how did that BCI even get on top of that floating branch right there? Like, come on, man. They only really climb when they're babies or when they're young to escape predators, and then they transition to more terrestrial snakes when they're older, and they just don't really climb, especially not in captivity.
Well, we may have one or two things here that aren't in books.
As a ghost corn snake and some other corn snake. He just throws it into a bag. Oh, blue tongue skink! Aww.
Well spotted.
Okay, so two-headed cobra, this thing isn't real.
Discovering something that doesn't exist.
So that's it looks like it has the markings of an Indian cobra, but it has the color of a red spitting cobra, and of course it has two heads.
And over here. The Tibetan third eye toad, we can't stop this fellow chanting.
Obviously not a real frog, kind of looks like a pixie frog though. Pixie frogs are very commonly kept as pets. They're quite friendly and they have huge, huge appetites.
Do you know snakes are more afraid of you than you are of them? When threatened, a snake will retreat to a place that is quiet and safe, a sanctuary where it can feel out of danger.
Yeah, he's absolutely right. Most often than not, if you get bit by a wild snake, it's because that snake is terrified of you and it's using all of its tools necessary to get you away from it.
Why are you running? Why are you running?
Of course, that's different if you get bit by a pet snake. You know, your snakes aren't very smart. Sometimes they'll mistake your hands for food and they'll bite you. Not that they're actually trying to kill you or consume you, but, you know, they're just not the smartest of animals.
I was wondering if you wouldn't mind milking Petunia for me.
Petunia?
So this is something that is actually fairly commonplace, is snake milking.
He loves to drink milk.
So Petunia looks like she's an albino variant of a Honduran or Pueblan milk snake. When you milk snakes, you don't milk their udders. Snakes don't have udders. Milking snakes is a process of taking a venomous snake's fangs, putting them into a cup, and then sort of milking the venom out of their venom glands to conduct studies and produce anti-venom. King snakes, of all forms, no matter the morph, are non-venomous, and hence you cannot actually milk.
My name is Jeff.
That was fun. Let me know if you want another one of these. Maybe I'll do another one. Who knows? Thanks again for watching. I would highly encourage you to like this video and subscribe as well.
Bazinga!
Bruh.